I'm Brian Spandel, and my business is Mill Lake Metal Finishing. When we receive a box of nickel, first thing we do is unbox everything. Hopefully they put a list in here of what they sent and how many pieces. It's really nice to know that. So we're getting it out of the box. And then what we do is we write down whose stuff it is and how many parts they sent. And then we'll take a picture of all of this. And on these here, we have four nickel pieces, and we have four pieces that are going to be copper. And as you can see on my little chalkboard there, that this is little Dickie Brennan stuff from Michigan. Tack it together with the wire feed, just in a couple spots, just to hold it where I want it. One thing you want to do is use plenty of flux. The flux actually really cleans it out. When you have a dirty spot on a piece and you melt the cast iron in there, it'll get a little pocket in it. And if the chunk of dirt is in there, it will not seal up. Every time you take the torch off, that little pocket will still be there. Alright, so here we're going to weld up a piece off of a 65-gallon farmer's boiler. It's the back of the stove. It's got a crack almost all the way through it. I'm going to put it on this little heater that I made with six burners on it. Start all the flames up and get it warmed up. Alright, so here we are. We're heating up this piece of cast. I got an infrared thermometer there that we're checking the heat. I like to start welding when it hits around 800, 900 degrees. And I like to weld over the flames. It seems to go a lot better for me. The only problem is it gets really hot. We're warming up the rod to put it in the flux. And we're going to weld all the way across this crack. This is the rod. It's about 1/4 inch square, made out of cast iron, just like the parts are made out of. It's the best way to weld this stuff. You heat up the ends, you put it in the flux, and the flux sticks to it. Heat up the spot that you're going to weld. After it gets hot, then kind of melt the flux into the part or whatever. That you can see the change in the flame when it hits the flux. It goes from a nice blue flame to orange. Really bright when you try to look at it without welding goggles on. So now we're going to smear this flux on, get the parts clean, put a little bit more flux on. You can never have enough flux. The main thing that you need to do. But the best time to do it is when it's about 40 below. And if you're noticing, I'm heating on the outside where there was a little bit more welding here, but I'm starting to heat it up on the outside where there was no crack. And the reason for that is it draws the heat all the way out to the edge. If you leave it cherry red in the middle and the outside isn't, it'll want to crack because the cast expands so much. So when I get done with this weld, then I take the torch and I keep that red that red all the way out to the edge of this part, and that keeps it from cracking. Generally when it cracks, it wants to crack in the opposite direction of the crack that you welded. It's a lesson learned over a few years of trying to do this. About ready here to see how it's getting red on the outside there. We're about ready to flip this thing over and weld the other side. Here I'm checking the temp just to make sure it's all staying pretty much the same temperature. That's kind of the key. If you get one spot that's 400 degrees and one spot that's 900 degrees, it wants to crack. And so now we're just going to not as thick a weld, but just go over this thing and one thing, the second side is always the easier side because all the flux has come through, so it's already a lot cleaner than the other side was. And you notice I'm heating up the outside there, bring the red into it instead of starting right in the middle of it. And we want to work this redness all the way out to the edge. See there, I'm just bringing that redness all the way out to the outside. It just helps pull all that really hot stuff out of the middle of the piece out to the edge. And there, that should about get this piece. Now we'll just leave this piece sit on the heater. We can turn the heat down a little bit and just leave it sit there and get all back to the same temperature and then just let it cool off. You can see how black it is. It's mostly the flux that's on there, and the flux is kind of greasy. If you try to just grind the weld off, any kind of grinding stone that you use, angle grind or whatever, it will gum them up and then they won't cut. So we sandblast this black stuff off. The one thing is you want to make sure that you get it off so that it, when you get done with these pieces, the flux can sometimes bleed through, especially on painted parts. And it'll turn, you'll get white wherever your repairs are. On nickel pieces, it usually you usually never see it because of all the acid tanks and the cleaning solutions that it's gone through. But on painted pieces, it can kind of be a problem. Acetone actually works pretty good for if you clean your welded areas with acetone for some reason, it kind of gets rid of the flux that's down in the porousness of the cast. Okay, so now you can see this piece is welded and there's a big lump in the middle. And so here you just got out of the sandblasting room with this. You want to grind this stuff down with an angle grinder and get it fairly close. Don't go too deep. And then it will be ready to take in and polish up for plating. A 7.5 horse bench grinder here, basically huge bench grinder. I have a rubber wheel on here. I start off with a 100 grit belt, and this is to get all the major pits and scratches and whatever else off. And you just start grinding on these pieces. You always want to go the lengthways the first time with the 100 grit. It's kind of what you want to do. And you just proceed to grind the whole piece with this 100 grit and get all the major stuff off. And now I'm putting on this little homemade guard that I made for doing beauty rings. Beauty rings and finial pieces are some of the more dangerous pieces to do because they like to cut you. And so when I'm spinning this ring, I have it rested on that piece of metal so it doesn't cut my leg. So basically I hold this thing, I put an extra old glove in my hand and hold this ring and just start to let it spin to get the smoothest job that I can. And then I just start angling it out and it just goes around and around until I've got all the scratches out of it and pits off this ring. So now we're working on a finial piece here that's kind of rough. Generally, I don't do finial pieces with 100 grit because there's not enough metal there to be that aggressive, but this was kind of thick and it required some 100 grit. Basically, when I do finial pieces, I use a screwdriver and I have these different shaped pieces of wood with a hole through the middle of them that I set over them to help hold the pieces. Too many cuts to my hands trying to hold them by hand and let them spin. Okay, now we were done with the 100 grit and we are switching to about a 450 grit belt. And now we want to go and do all these same pieces and we want to go the opposite direction that we just did. So we're going to start with this swing top, and you notice before on the 100 grit we were going all the way around it. Now we're just going up and down the sides, crisscrossing the grain. This is the dangerous part when I pretty much wear that beauty ring around me. If it was to ever grab that belt and pull down, I'm sure I'd have a nice little slice in my back. But you just make sure that you don't get too close to the edge. As a safety warning, I could just tell you, don't try this at home. And so you just go round and round until you get all the 100 grit scratch marks off of this. This is the easiest belt that I have. It's the one that takes the shortest amount of time and takes the least amount of belts. I usually have about 20 pieces in there at a time that I'm doing. At one time, it'll probably take me 8 or 9 of the 100 grit belts. It'll take one 450 grit belt on average. And when I get up to the 700 grit belts, 2 or 3 of those, just because they're so fine. And now we're working on a beauty ring. Same thing again, crisscrossing the grain. The first step here is fairly safe. Just going around and around. After a while, you just kind of know how long to grind on it to get the 100 grit scratch marks off instead of looking at it after every time. Actually, none of my belts have a grit number on there as per se as regular standard abrasive belts or sandpaper does. This particular belt is called an X22. The last one was an X45. The one before that was an X100. The X22 that we just put on is equal to about 700 grit. And so now we're going the same way we did with the 100 grit belt. And the reason that we're going in that same direction is when it comes time to polish, it's a lot easier to polish the up and down like we did with the 450 grit belt. My polishing is done with red treated air buff wheels that we have, 16 inches is how big they are. And then the compound, which what we're putting on, is for stainless steel. And basically what you're doing is this compound got mostly animal fat in it. And so when you put it on these wheels, it gets hot, it melts on, and that's what holds it onto the wheels. And so you have to keep putting it on all the time. You can kind of tell when you're running out of the compound, it kind of wants to bounce a little bit because the wheels are dry. And so you put more compound on and polish this up until you get near finish. After we're done polishing the parts, there's a greasy film that we have to get off, so we're cleaning these parts with lacquer thinner and toothbrushes, kind of big toothbrushes. We just have to get the stuff off. A lot of shops I see nickel done that doesn't do the cleaning, and it won't plate over these big chunks of this black stuff. And so scrub them down really good. The cleaner they are, the better they'll turn out. Do the back sides, get the dust off. Wipe them off with paper towel and pack them away and take them to the plater. All right, so this is the first part when you bring your nickel up to the platers. He's got these racks. He wraps copper wire around the top piece there, then wires your parts on with this copper wire. And they basically stick the wire through a hole if it's available. And then kind of give it a twist out so that it holds the piece solid, so it's not loose on there. Otherwise, if you lose contact, it won't plate. So there you can see he's doing the second hole in this. This is just the main plate. And there is, you put it on that rack, and there it is. There's a piece that's ready to go. Generally, there'd be three or four pieces hanging on that one wire. So here we have a rack of nickel parts, and the first thing that we're going into here is a soap tank. We'll just clean any grease and oils and any of that kind of dust off of these parts. The parts are pretty clean when we get done with the lacquer thinner. And this is going to sit in here for about 3 or 4 minutes. Okay, so after this has sat in here for a few minutes, we are going into a rinse tank. When you actually do this nickel process for a piece of nickel, it's like 18 tanks that it goes through before it's done. After the rinse tank here, we're going into what's called an electroclean. The temperature on this stuff is 150 degrees. Down that soap tank, it was 150 degrees. And then that just sits in there for a little bit. Now we're doing another rinse tank. Now this is a pretty small setup here, being that it's all done by hand. Some of the bigger plating shops that I've been in, the tanks are approximately 15 to 20 foot long. Everything is done with chain hoist, all electric. There's no lifting all the stuff. And so yeah, we just came out of a rinse tank. This is a hose rinse. In fact, the tank that it was just in was a sulfuric acid and then a rinse. And now they do a spray rinse, so they actually just spray it off with water. And the next thing it goes to will be the nickel. The nickel is the one that sits in the longest. 40 minutes it sits in this nickel tank. It takes a while for it to pull all the way around these parts. This tank is about 135 degrees. It basically looks kind of like a hot tub in there. It's all bubbling and swirling around. There are actually little bags of nickel squares that hang in here. With the electricity on, it dissolves these little squares of nickel and it flows through the acid and adheres to the part. So it's been 40 minutes and there, we have parts that are nickeled. In case you're wondering what the green stuff is there, that's a piece here, this demonstrator piece that I have out front here for you. And I just had them only nickel plate just a part of it so I could show you the differences between all the, from sandblasting all the way up to the nickel parts. Now we're just going into some more rinse tanks. One of these rinse tanks is a chromium rinse, and the reason for that is, especially beauty rings, the tin pieces on finials, this chromium will actually go on the backside and helps protect it from rusting. I don't know if you've ever noticed when you get parts back, the backsides on some of the stuff will rust because if it's not polished, it doesn't plate it very well. So these parts have just come out of a couple of rinse tanks. And then this last one, this chromiatic rinse, it's actually more like a hot soap. And you just leave that one sit in there for a couple minutes. The main reason is to get the parts hot so that when you take them out, they'll dry fast. Some of the rinse tanks are cold water, not hot water. So that'll just sit in there for 2 minutes, get hot, and the parts will dry. So the last thing we do once we get the nickel back home, I use this paint. Plasticoat makes it. It's called HP11, and not everybody wants it. Not every part can be darkened, but this is my process of darkening the background or antiquing it, and I just spray this stuff on. It dries in approximately 10 minutes. After we spray these pieces and it's dried, you take 4-0 steel wool and just buff off the excess paint. All the background stuff will stay. Some people like a little bit lighter on the background as far as the black goes. If you want it lighter, you can just actually use a toothbrush to get into the background and buff it a little bit lighter. myself, I prefer a little bit darker, but this is a reflector off of an estate base burner, and you can see it doesn't take very long at all. I know I've talked to some people that spend half a day trying to wipe the paint off of their nickel parts with lacquer thinner and rags and everything else. I can do a base burner in about a half an hour with this process. There's one piece that's darkened and one piece that's not darkened. Pretty much everybody thinks that the darkened looks a lot better than without it.